Hello, and today we're going to have a look at the Cobweb model. Now, before we look at the Cobweb model, let's try and understand a bit of background behind it. So normally we have markets which are assumed to be efficient, demand equals supply, and you know everything, there's adjustment mechanisms should anything change to keep the market in check and equilibrium. However, there are some industries where this is not the case and prices are not stable. So what we saw with the agricultural market is that production would vary year on year, and as a result we would see price fluctuations. Now these fluctuations are actually really interesting because these are the things that lead to cyclical developments, and they lead to cycles being developed, and it leads to even more speculation that where are we on this cycle and how can I make the most out of this cycle. So it's actually a really interesting area, and in terms of A-level economics, Cobweb theory comes into market failure because here we have a market failure where the market is not stabilizing and reaching an equilibrium. Things are fluctuating on a year-on-year basis. So how the Cobweb model works is we have two key assumptions: that goods that are produced in this market are perishable, i.e. you can't hold on to them. And the second thing is that people, the producers, they have naive or adaptive expectations. And by this we mean that their expectations about the future of the market are based on past experiences. So with naive expectations, yes, this price is equal to today's price. With adaptive, it's to do with their past experiences, how they've felt and how they've dealt with. So they're trying to learn from their lessons. So it's a bit more than naive expectations, but still their decisions about the future are based on decisions about the past. And this is important because markets within which Cobweb is used, they tend to be markets where supply is inelastic and it requires a sort of prior production. So it's not just like I want to produce tights, go to a factory and produce tights. It's more like, okay, I want to produce some livestock, and for that I'm going to need X amount of time to grow it, etc., and to develop this product. So now let's look at the Cobweb model diagrammatically, how it explains it. What we do is we start off with normal demand and supply diagram with price on the y-axis and quantity on the x-axis. And we have the equilibrium P1 and Q1. I've shown supply to be relatively inelastic and demand to be just normal elasticity. And the reason for this is because the market we're going to look at is agricultural industry. And where what happens is if you want potatoes or something, you need to plant the seeds or whatever crops, I don't know much about agriculture, but whatever crops they are, you need to plan for their, you know, some time in advance. So what happens? So let's move on to the next diagram. So let's say in any particular year there was a natural disaster, which meant that supply was substantially cut. So instead of Q1, we're now producing at Q2. Now notice the actual supply curve hasn't shifted because we haven't seen like any kind of technological change, which means that for the same price we can now produce a lot more, or for the same price we can produce a lot less. It isn't a factor like that. It just means that our actual productivity is curbed to a Q2. Now, what happens is the suppliers realise that at Q2, there's still quite a lot of demand for it. And to get up to the demand, we use the red, the curve with the red stroke, and we go up to meet the demand curve. Now, this red stroke shows the excess demand that there is in comparison to supply. And when there's excess demand and less supply, as one would expect, the price goes up. So as you can see in this year, the price has shot up to P2. So then what happens is the next year, the producers, the farmers, they're really happy. Price has gone up to P2. This is great. Let's keep production at P2. So at P2, in order to determine how much, you know, seeds to plant for agriculture, you go across to the supply curve to realise that actually the right production for P2 is a production of Q3. So they plant it. What happens when, you know, this product comes to life? Like, we have all this product now. It's being made. Well, essentially, the supply has been produced at the right level for P2, but the demand now is much less than supply, and this is shown by the second red stroke, which shows that there is much more demand than supply. And as a result, we see the price decreasing, because remember, more products, less people wanting it, price falls. And the price then falls, we follow it through to P3. Now, essentially, this cobweb would keep going on, where now what would happen is we would say, okay, price is at P3, we're no longer going to produce as much as we did before at P3. How much should production be? Well, we look at where does the supply curve meet at P3. That would be a Q4. I haven't drawn it in, but you get the idea, and you can see loads of examples of the actual drawing. It's more to do with the concept. You'd be at Q4, and at Q4, then what would happen is demand would outweigh supply, and so the price would shoot up again, and we would get a new price, P4. And then, you know, they would base their expectations about the future, these producers, based on the past, and a cobweb would develop. So I've just taken any picture off the internet to show three different ways in which these cobwebs developed, and we have names for them. So we have convergent, divergent, and what this diagram calls continuous, or I'd call oscillating. And essentially what it's showing is the direction in which the cobweb moves. So in a convergent, which is the example I gave, you're moving towards an equilibrium in the long run. The price swings are getting smaller and smaller. Whereas in a divergent cobweb, the price swings are getting bigger and bigger, and you're moving away from that central equilibrium that we began our model with. And in an oscillating, it goes on and on. It's not, then they're just equidistant apart, the price changes. And how do we determine whether a market will have a convergent, divergent, or oscillating market? Well, this is all to do with elasticities. So when the elasticity of the supply is more inelastic than demand, so as we saw with agriculture, it's harder to change how much supply there is when there's a price change as opposed to demand, then we have a convergent cycle, a convergent cobweb, and when there's supply changes more quickly than demand would change, say it's a necessity like water or something, and we could change supply, then we would get a divergent a cobweb where the price fluctuations, swings in them are much more greater. So that brings us to the end of the cobweb, and what I will do in my next video is essentially I will apply this cobweb to a real life industry, the property market, and look at why cycles exist, trying to use this model to explain. Thank you for watching.